you've met certain African Americans and you believe that some of them are Israelites. So the question is, what about them and you meeting them led you to believe that they were Israelites?
I just told you.
You didn't tell me. You said that you met them and that you believe that they some of them are Israelites. So what about meeting these particular people led you to believe they were Israel?
Spirit, prophecy, curses, geography, history, they all go through the same thing. They all have the same spirit of who they were in the Bible, who it was talking about.
Okay, so let's deal with that. So you said
some of them was like, man, that's not me. Not well, okay. Well, that's maybe that you don't know what I'm talking about.
Okay, so here's the thing. So from your viewpoint, they have to agree with the doctrines that you believe in order to be Israel.
The Bible. No. I have no doctrine. I don't know. I know nothing. All I know, I read the Bible, and I get an understanding on scriptures from precepts and precepts, line upon line. I don't have a doctrine that says, "Oh, this is right." That's all I know is the Christian church that I grew up in.
You said something that was incorrect. Isaiah 28 and 10, where it says precept must be upon precept in the King James. Do you know that the words must be are in italics? They're not in the Hebrew text underneath the translation. Let me just finish.
No, you're talking bullshit. I was just paraphrasing the scripture, and now you want to act like
that's Isaiah. That is Isaiah 28 and 10.
Yeah, thank you.
Isaiah 28 and 10 is not talking about how you read the Bible. What it's talking about is the people murmuring against the words of the prophet. And we know this for an absolute fact, because if you look at Isaiah 28 and 13, it literally says, "But the word of the Lord shall be unto them, precept upon precept, line upon line, here a little and there a little, that they might go and fall backward, be broken, snared, and taken. It was a word of rebuke for their murmuring, for their disrespect." And that is why the Lord brought judgment upon them.
Kind of like you are very disrespectful to people that you don't even know.
So let's deal with this in Deuteronomy 28. So you said curses and prophecy. So here's what I want to ask. What curses and prophecy specifically do you believe identify you as Israel from Deuteronomy 28?
Yeah, pick one.
Okay, here we got one right here. Beautiful one. 36. 36 reads, "The Lord will bring you and your king, whom you set over you, to a nation that neither you nor your fathers have known." When did you ever go into captivity with a king?
I don't remember.
Your past life, so you believe in reincarnation. I'm gonna cut you on that in a second too. Let's go to 52. They shall besiege you in all your towns, your towns. So this can't possibly be your towns if you're starting from the viewpoint of the transatlantic slave trade, because the slaves were brought over from West and Central Africa to this
country. Did I say some of them? And you said not all of them. I said not all of them.
You said pick some one, of them. You said pick
yeah,
one.
Pick
though.
One. Okay,
so that don't fit you. So that don't pick you. Okay, so you haven't eaten the fruit of your offspring and all that other stuff. You know that you haven't eaten the fruit of your womb. You haven't done none of that, right?
Nah, man.
Okay, so then since you haven't done that, you don't fit this other one, then which one in this chapter? Because if you look at this chapter, you're going to notice that it says, in the land, this shall happen to you in the land, from the land, you shall be plucked from the land. This entire chapter is contingent on the land. The whole reason that they went into captivity was from the land. The very term exile, captivity, is being taken from the land of Israel into a different land as captives. Not from the west coast of Africa it's not from a captivity to another captivity. It's from the land of Israel into a captivity.
Right.
Now, how could that be applicable to you? None of these curses fit you because none of them are talking about you. It's all contingent on the land promise that the Israelites were entering into, because we see this in Deuteronomy 4. So right off the bat, this chapter isn't talking about you. So what else do you got? Since we know this isn't talking about you, none of it is talking about you, then what is talking about you?
I mean, that's what you say.
Okay, let's look at this right here.
I mean, you just a hater, I guess.
I'm not a hater.
There's Christians that are haters of other Christians. There are non-religious persons that are haters of other non-religious persons.
Verse 10, "And all the peoples of the earth shall see that you are called by the name of the Lord. They shall be afraid of you. And the Lord will make you abound in prosperity in the fruit of your womb and in the fruit of your livestock and in the fruit of your ground within the land that the Lord swore to your fathers to give you. That's why when you get down here, you're going to notice that all the curses are contingent on the land. When it talks about cursed shall you be in the city, which city? Their city. Cursed shall you be in the field, which field? Their field. Cursed shall be your basket and your kneading bowl. Cursed shall be your the fruit of your womb and the fruit of your ground, the increase of your herds and the young of your flock. Cursed shall you be when you come in and cursed shall you be when you go out. Meaning that, and look at this, 21, the Lord will make the pestilence stick to you until he has consumed you off the land that you are entering to take possession of it. All of this is contingent on the land, sir. So in order for you to try to make this about you, you do got to fit everything here. Because if the Israelites entered into a contract, the contract was the old covenant. This was before they entered into the land. The sealing of the blood of bulls and goats, because we know that's what Moses did to seal the covenant. The people were entering into the promise to obey the words of the law, the commandments. That's why when you go to 27, you're going to notice what it says. Right when it segues into 28, it literally will tell you at the very bottom of 26, cursed be anyone who does not confirm the words of this law by doing them. And all the people shall say amen. Notice there's a cursed be anyone who take a bribe to shed innocent blood, and the people shall say amen. Cursed be anyone who strikes down his neighbor in secret, and the people shall say amen. All of this was being done so they enter into the contract, the covenant. That's why when you get to 28, these are in the fullness what's going to happen. Blessings if you obey, curses if you disobey. And 29 is very clear that this is talking about the contract that they're entering into the covenant. You go to 29, 10 all the way to 15, it says, you are standing today, all of you, before the Lord your God, the heads of your tribes, your elders, your officers, all the men of Israel, your little ones, your wives, the sojourner who is in your camp, from the one who chops your wood to the one who draws your water, so that you may enter into the sworn covenant of the Lord your God, which the Lord your God is making with you today, that he may be, that he may establish you today as his people, and that he may be your God, as he promised and as he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, and Jacob. It is not with you alone that I am making this sworn covenant, but with whoever is standing with us here today. That included the stranger, these people right here, the Gentile, the literal Gentiles, who is standing with us here today before the Lord our God, and with whoever is not here with us today. That's talking about people in the future in the old covenant time frame. So this is talking about the curses of the covenant. You're not under the old covenant. That wasn't a covenant made with you. It wasn't made with your people group. It wasn't made, and you can't prove that you're Israelite trying to use Deuteronomy 28, so you got to do something else. What else do you have as proof, so-called? You have anything else?
Huh? Oh, man, I'm telling you, you talk more to my wife, man. You just be babbling on about a bunch of bullshit.
So what else you got? Oh, so you calling the Bible bullcrap? That's what you call the Bible?
I'm calling you, not the Bible.
I was reading the Bible. No, you just called the Bible bullcrap. No, you just called
it. I called you.
No, you called the Bible bullcrap. So do me a favor. So
again, that's what you real good at. Sir, you real good at lying, man.
So go ahead and pull your scriptures.
You may have a spirit of a lion. You have a lion spirit.
What else do you have? Because so far, Deuteronomy 28 ain't it. That ain't talking about you. So what else you got? What else you got?
Oh man, this dude right here, dude, you are feminine.
Bad man, you getting beat up real bad. All right, so what else you got?
Not at all. If it is, it's with a bunch of feathers.
Well, why don't you? Yeah, the ones that are coming out of you, you getting beat up like a stuffed chicken, man.
No, I don't get beat up. I don't have feelings.
Okay, you don't got feelings. So then, come out your feelings, because I think you.
I don't have any to come out of.
Okay, so then go pull your scriptures. What scriptures you got to prove that you're an Israelite? You haven't demonstrated that you're an Israelite, so prove it.
To who? You?
No,
sir. You would not even reconcile the fact that you lied on me, so why would I even?
Because no one lied on you, so I need you to prove you're an Israelite.
Yeah,
so
what you did.
What's your proof?
Okay. I mean, just because you are hard of hearing and you have a problem with comprehending plain English.
I have a problem comprehending how you're not pulling your scriptures to show that you're an Israelite.
I mean, that's because you didn't listen to what I said, and I said it very calm and nicely.
Yeah,
as I could. You just ignored it like you're doing now.
Pull your scriptures. You haven't pulled any scriptures. You're asserting it, but you haven't proven it. Pull your scriptures. Right. What scriptures you got? Go ahead. Pull your scriptures. What are your scriptures? What scriptures you got? You have to have something, right? You got to prove this from the Bible. So what are your scriptures? I'm waiting for you to pull them scriptures, man. You got your sword next to you. Go get your sword. Show me from the scriptures that you're an Israelite. I'm waiting.
Right. I'm waiting on you.
So you got your scriptures? Go pull your scriptures.
I got all my scriptures, but I'm waiting on you.
Okay, give me your scriptures.
Sir, I'm waiting on you.
Didn't you hear me say I want you to give me your scriptures proving you're an Israelite?
Didn't you hear me say that I have an op with you about saying I'm relying on me?
I think you're deceived. So why don't you pull those scriptures instead of complaining about something imaginary? Go pull your scriptures.
Me saying that you lied on me.
Pull your scriptures.
When I feel that way,
this is a red herring. This is a red herring.
Say,
this is a red herring. Yes, it is. This is a red herring. This is a red herring. You're trying to get away from the argument. What are your scriptures proving you're an Israelite? What are your scriptures proving you're an Israelite, sir? This is a red herring from you. What are your scriptures?
Man, you are very feminine.
What are your scriptures? What are your
scriptures? You like saying all that stuff? I have no feelings at all.
No, you're
no,
in your feelings.
There's no words you can say.
All up in your feelings. You get your
no words
on.
You can say to change.
How on. I feel.
There's nothing you can say to change my aura. There's nothing you can say to change my attitude. There's nothing you can say that'll make me happy, sad, glad. None of that.
Look at that. Look, the audience. Look what the audience is saying about you.
I'm not looking at that stuff. I'm just sitting here. The phone is on my computer desk.
So why don't you do me a favor and get your scriptures? Because you said you got them. You just finished saying that you got them, unless you just bore false witness there. So get your scriptures and tell me. Come on. What are your scriptures? Show me that you're an Israelite. Prove it. Demonstrate it. Come on. What are your scriptures? I don't think you have scriptures.
Okay,
then pull your scriptures then. In fact, give me your scriptures and I'll pull them up on my screen and we'll read them together. So what are your scriptures? Come on, Chad. Come on now. Come on, man. Come on, bro.
My scripture is you bearing false witness. That's my scripture.
So where is your scriptures proving that you're an Israelite? We can do this all day, man.
Yeah, we sure can.
So what are your scriptures proving you're an Israelite? You got your scriptures?
Yes.
Okay, so then what are your scriptures? Give me the verses. What are the verses?
I already just told you. You didn't want to discuss it.
Okay, what are the verses?
You bearing false witness on your brother.
Red herring. I didn't bear false witness on you. So what are your scriptures proving you're an Israelite? Yeah, that's right, Alfredo, man. This guy. So what are your scriptures, man? Why are you afraid? You seem like you're afraid right now. Am I intimidating you?
No, man. I don't know you from a campaign.
Okay, so then pull your scriptures. Come on, man. This is not a good look for you, man. Come on.
I mean, why would I care what looks good on me or who thinks what? That's what you keep thinking. I want to make some kind of impression to someone, to a whole bunch of people in your group that I don't know from nowhere.
I know of
Cameron only because I grew up with his uncle. I don't even know Cameron. I couldn't pick him out of a lineup. I don't know them.
Here's the problem, though, Chad. The thing is that you're trying to so-called wake people up into the so-called truth. You're trying to get people to come back to the law, statutes, and commandments.
All I want to do is bang on Christians for being hypocrites.
Okay, so then I'm banging on you for being a hypocrite. So go ahead and prove that you're an Israelite.
Yeah, I'm not a hypocrite.
Oh, yes, you are. You've been cussing, like I said. What does Ephesians 5:4 say about cussing?
I haven't cussed. I didn't put a curse on anyone.
No. Cussing in our vernacular means that you're using vulgarity. You have been using vulgarity. Yes, you have.
Whose vernacular?
What do you mean? In this vernacular, the one that you're speaking today? Or do you think that it only means one vernacular, one tongue? Or do you mean...
No, I'm trying to see. I was asking a simple question.
Okay, so the Ephesians 5:4. When it talks about not using vulgar speech, why are you using vulgar speech?
I didn't say anything vulgar. I didn't use any vulgarity.
S-bomb, you talk about the S-bomb, you talk about GD.
That's not a vulgarity.
Yes, all of that is vulgarity.
It is not.
Yes, they do. If you go in, yes, they do. Yes,
that's not vulgarity.
That is a vulgarity. Yes, in
vulgarity,
our
vulgarity is something that's vulgar.
Yes, that is vulgar.
That's not vulgar.
That is vulgar, sir.
It's not.
Yes, it is.
That's common slang.
You're using vulgar slang.
No.
Yes, it does.
That's not vulgar. It's just slang.
Ephesians 5:4.
That is not vulgar. It's just
absolutely
slang.
Actually, it is.
Do you know what? That's just how you grew up. I didn't grow up with that being vulgar.
In the game room, it scared me.
Man, you doggone shame. You gonna cuss in front of your kids, man. You a foul dude, man. You
see, first of all, when I was speaking to you saying that, my kids are outside playing. They're not in
they
here.
And they would have came up in here, you would have been cussing, dropping GD in front of your kids?
As soon as they came in the door, my language would have changed. I don't speak.
Oh, okay. So why does it change? You said it's not vulgar speech. Wait a minute. You just said it wasn't vulgar speech. Why should it change? According to your logic, why should it change at all if it's not bad, according to you?
I didn't say it was. I said it wasn't vulgar.
Okay.
Because that is language that adults use, and my kids are not adults, so they speak.
That language. I don't talk that way. I don't got
your choice.
I don't got to.
But that's your choice. Sir, that's your choice. You can't tell me how to a grown man how to speak around other grown men. You have no problem with it. And if you have a problem with it, you just say it. All you have to do, sir, was say, sir.
Look.
No, you're lying.
No filthiness nor foolish talk.
Let there be no filthiness
nor foolish talk nor crude joking, which are out of place, but instead let there be thanksgiving. You didn't do that.
No, all you had to say was, sir, that language is offensive to me. And I said, okay, same thing when I'm around my mother. She doesn't like that kind of, so I said, okay, if you don't want me to speak like that around you, I will respect you, and I won't, I try my best to refrain from it.
Verse 8, Colossians 3:8.
So I can say what I want to say in my own house, and use whatever language I want.
But you in my room. But now you must put all away, anger, wrath, malice, slander, obscene talk.
In my own house.
Obscene talk from your mouth.
That's not obscene to me. And if it's obscene to you, you should have said, sir, I find that offensive. And I would have apologized and said, okay,
very
different language. But no, because you are just, you don't make no sense. If something's offensive to you, how would I know that's offensive to you? I don't know you. All you have to say, sir, you're offensive. I would have said, oh, I'm sorry. I would try not to speak that way in your presence.
Oh, okay. That's how we're playing it. Okay. All right.
No, that's really, that's how men do things.
So then,
if I do something that you find offensive, how would I know it's offensive if you don't open your mouth and tell me?
So then now let's be on record. That language is offensive in this room, so I don't want you to use that language in this room.
And I would do my best, and I would refrain from using it. That's not that hard.
All right. Now I'm going to
answer your vocabulary too. I can do other words.
I am going to answer your question from earlier. I'm going to do the same thing with you. You earlier felt that I was bearing false witness on you. I don't believe I was bearing false witness on you. However, if you feel that I was bearing false witness, I was not. However, if you felt offended and you felt that that's what I was trying to do, which I wasn't, then I apologize to you for that as well. Now, can we move forward?
Man, I don't know. Why did it take so long just to do that? We could have did that in 30 seconds. Okay, just so like that, you told me, I corrected myself. Like, sir, I didn't mean to offend you. And then now we can go on.
Because
you just want to hear yourself talk. You're
interrupting me. You're asking me a question.
And you're doing the same thing. And I can do it better than you. I can interrupt you better than you can interrupt me. I don't like it. I just want to talk.
You ask
and then
me
when
a
I
question.
Stop, then you talk.
So the Bible tells you not to do railing for railing. You just admitted that you're doing railing for railing.
No. I said, all I want to hear you say.
You cut, man.
Give an apology. Then I'm saying, okay, we're good. Because I understand you have a group, and that's what you do. You talk, and you talk and talk. We'll talk. I don't care.
Okay, so now that we have established that we have both apologized to one another for what we perceived that was offensive to us, then let's go ahead and move forward. So the question that I asked you was, you said that you had scriptures proving that you're an Israelite. Can you please show me those scriptures showing that you're an Israelite, please? Thank you. I mean, we apologize, so let's go ahead and move forward. Do you have those scriptures proving that you're an Israelite? Chad? Mr. Chad, can you hear me? Hello? I don't know if he can hear me, if that's my signal or his. Oh boy. Let me make sure that's him. Yeah, that is him. Judah Israel, you know, Chad, are you there? I don't know if you're there. I can't hear you. I don't see your screen moving. Oh, he dropped out, man. This dude done dropped out. All right, we're going to see if Chad comes back in. We are going to see if he comes back in. All right. All right. I think the audience is enjoying this, but I certainly want to have a conversation with Chad so I can glean what his position is exactly, because this is absolutely ridiculous, man. All right, so he's dropped out. We will wait for him to come back in. I assume that he's having connection issues. Hopefully. I'm not trying to, as he calls it, bear false witness, so I don't want to presume that I know what's going on. So we're just going to wait for him to come back in. For the audience out there, I want to thank all of y'all for tuning on in. I definitely see you guys watching, and I appreciate it. We're just going to wait for him to come back in, so I'm going to give him approximately 5 minutes, you know. And for anyone who wants to come in the meantime, here's the join link. So any brother and sister who would like to join is more than welcome. So let me drop this join link. Anybody can come up in here while we wait for Chad to come up in here, because I don't want to talk by myself. I'm going to give him about 5 minutes. Right, exactly, Wesley. Yeah, I hope he didn't leave. I hope he didn't get his flea on. Proverbs 28 in one style. So, if anyone would like to come in, definitely come up in here, y'all, as we wait for our good friend Chad to come back in here.